So the question is, my mind, the mind of Christ versus our mind. The mind of Christ versus our mind. Because in many situations, or in many situations in life, you will find that our mind is completely different than the mind of God, and we look to things with a different perspective, and we take things to a different perspective in our life. So the outline of the retreat will be the mind of God versus my mind, a tabernacle, a model of the mind of Christ, and how to have the mind of Christ in our life. The third talk, and the last talk, is creating your family mission statement. And this talk will be the talk that you will get the gifts for the first families that they will be working, or they will get this ready. So tomorrow evening I will give you a homework. It's optional for those who are going to take it serious. There is a reward for those who are going to take it other than this. It will be other than a reward. So what is the difference? My question to you is, what is the difference between our mind and the mind of God? What is the difference? We are limited. God is unlimited. What else? He is righteous in his thinking and we are not. Definitely. What else? Excellent. But what do you mean by self-consumed? Thank you. We are only thinking about ourselves and we are obsessed with ourselves. And unfortunately, this leads to many, many problems in our life, while God is not. Any...
We judge by what we see, by spiritual.
Yes, we judge by what we see from outside, but God is seeing and looking to the heart. A funny story, there was a mom that was walking with her daughter, and the daughter had two apples in her hands. So each hand has an apple. So the mom told her, "You're not going to give me one." So she told her, "Okay, sure, I will give you one." Then she had a bite from the first apple. Then she took another bite from the second apple. And the mom's facial expressions started being... looking weird. What's going on? Why she is doing this? What would you think about this setting? What would you say about the girl? Actually, this was the answer of the girl. The first thing that came to the mind of the people is, this is weird. Why you are taking a bite from the two apples? Just at least pick one and make your choice. But she told mom, I'm taking the bites. Or I took bites from each one, so as I will see which is more sweet, and I will give it to you. The whole point, sometimes we are thinking or we are judging, we're quick judging others or situations or things that we go through without knowing exactly. Maybe God is looking to a completely different setting in our life. In Isaiah chapter 55, verse 9, very, very, very nice verse. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. As heaven is higher than earth, and when you are looking even to the sky, not the heaven, how far is the distance, and how big and major difference is there? And it is, I don't know, I've seen this this picture before. So The whole difference between our thoughts and the thoughts of God is completely different than what would we think. So I will give you some examples. Who is greatest? When you ask yourself who is greatest, and the first thing you this is a sad but funny story. People just came from Egypt. They don't speak that much of good English, so they joined the church, and people, they are just newcomers and looking a little bit down, and you don't say it, but you feel that there is something awkward in the situation. And these people who came from Egypt, they were riding the latest Mercedes car, even more the latest than even many of the people in the congregation is riding. And once people saw their car, there is a huge shift in how they are dealing with those exact same people. And this is very weird and very awkward, because when you deal with a person, you don't deal with what is the car that he is riding, or the status, whether he a doctor or a lawyer or an engineer. Because who is greatest in our mind is different than who is greatest in the mind of God. Who is greatest in our mind is different than who is greatest in the mind of God. You remember Good Thursday? What did the Lord do? He washes their feet and he told them, do you think who is greatest? I am your master and I am the one who is washing your feet, and you ought also to do so. So just the concept of greatness, we have a completely different setting. Who is greater and what is greater? And sometimes you will be living up to the Jones, trying to get whatever your neighbors or whatever the people who are around you, or we are obsessed with the idea, you know what, this man got the latest Lexus and we cannot afford it and we don't have even the money for it, but I will sell my own car, even if I am going to lose, then I'm going to take loan and I'm going to get this car so as I will be in that status. And this is very sad, because the whole point, your value is not in your possessions. Your value is not in your possessions. And we will come to this maybe in the session number 3. So another example is the acceptable offering. Do you remember the lady, the old lady, the old widow that gave 2 mites? And Christ did like a business meeting. He it sat like this, and he sat like this in front of the donation box or in front of the place where people were donating. And the Lord called all the disciples and told them, have you seen this lady? She has put more than everyone else. So think of this. We'll have maybe 30 people or 40 people here in this room. We'll assume that each one of us donated $100, and this is $4,000. So an illiterate, very weird looking old lady come with 2 cents, and she's putting 2 cents in the donation box. And God is saying that those 2 cents is more than all our donation collected together, which is, when you on paper, it is much, much, much more less. But in the eyes of God and the mind of God, is completely different. And so forth. For the sake of the time, what do you think about yourself? Sometimes you have a completely different setting of really who you are. Or you are trying to put the front in front of others. But deeply, deeply, deeply inside, it's completely different. We did this. We'll do this together. So I will ask you to have your cell phones on. Okay, it's a poll online. What you are going to do is very simple. So you bring your cell phones and we'll answer this question. If you want to answer that question, it is anonymous. This poll is anonymous. And you text, you will be always texting to this number, 37607. If you want to text Abuna David, you will write the number of Abuna David in the text, the numbers. Then you will, in the body of the text, you will, hi Abuna David, I haven't seen you today in church. So the number that you are going to text to is 37607. The number, you write your answer, and your answer, you write 9818 before your answer. Are you there? Are you there? Okay. So the question is, what do you think of popularity? What is the first thing that comes to your mind when you think of popularity? Send the text to this number. And if you missed this number before your answer, okay, someone got it already. Testing. Okay, it is working. famous actor, money. Fashion, vanity. Cheerleaders and football players. Yeah. Power. Group of colleagues or friends. Owning positions, beautiful people. Celebrities again. I think it is repeating, I'm not sure. Materialism. Okay, so we'll move to the next question. It is the same idea. When you think of love, what is the first thing that comes to your mind? It is the same number you will text to, but this is the number that you will put in the body of the text. So it is, the four questions are the same questions, but just the term. So now we are I'm asking you about love. Family. God, family. Christ. Honor. Marriage. The cross, God loves for us. Lucky, family again. Self-sacrifice. Unconditional. Mother. Very true. Third question. When you think of fun, what is the first thing that comes to your mind? Same number, but different number in the body of the text. Golf. Family vacation. Skiing. Sleep. Vacation and beach. Kids playing. Cancun. Quality time with family. Fun as a goal in life. Family retreat. This is very positive. I hope HTC retreat, okay. Children, Christ. Happiness. Sports. Laughter. Disneyland. Spending time together. Wife and gym. It is anonymous. It's supposed to be anonymous. Okay. Last question. Why we are doing this? Why we are doing this poll online? Because we did the same with Youth Anonymously a couple of years back. And you will see their answers, and they were really, really showing the real themselves or the real self. And they didn't put anything just for the sake of, what are you expecting the church will, in the church when you are being asked to this? This is what you should answer. So the concept of success, this is the last question, joy, hard work, Sam Khalil. I don't know who is Sam Khalil. Okay. Heaven, reward, satisfaction, raising children in the fear of God. Going to heaven. Corporate position and leadership role, lots of money, balance, meet goals, life well lived, godly children, think of this, if this is good that I know some of the people, but I don't know all of the people. Think of this. A husband or a wife, the success for them is lots of money. Okay? They are married to a husband or a wife. That's saying godly children is success. How their life will look like? What? Big conflicts. And because what you really value, even we're speaking about one value, and we're speaking about completely different approaches and definitions of the same value. And here, really, when we realize the mind of God, we are united indirectly. If I am thinking completely different than my wife, and my wife is thinking completely different than me, and we are having a debate, let us forget my definition of success as a godly children and your definition of success as a lots of money, and let us see what the definition of God of success. You understand my point? And here, when the mind of God will unite us as a family and as a congregation, and even will unite us from within. Family, happiness, love, choosing the right wife, fulfilling your potential and calling. So let me share with you the answers that the youth answered. The survey with the youth. It happened here in US, in Los Angeles. Popularity is to fit in the social norm, but to define popularity is not to fit in the social norm, but to define the social norm. This is our interpretation of popularity. When we ask the youth, look, a mom or a dad who are thinking that success equals lots of money will be driving all their life for their kids to be successful by making good money. And making good money will be only in two careers, being a doctor or a lawyer. And now we are filtering the whole Coptic community in those two categories. If you are not a doctor or a lawyer, then you are a failure. I remember speaking with one of the youth, and I don't recall exactly what she picked, but she picked studying communication or English literature or something like this. And when I asked her about what is your major, and she was very embarrassed to say. And I always quickly recognized that she's feeling embarrassed. She's feeling embarrassed because she is not up to the level of whether a lawyer or a doctor. So popularity, when we ask the kids, this is what they said. You have to fit in with whatever they are doing. Follow the crowd. This was their definition of popularity. But when you return back to what the Lord is telling us in the scripture, enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction, and there are many who go in by it. So God, in the mind of God, popularity is not a big deal. If you want to be popular and you want to follow the crowd and do whatever they are doing to fit in, this is very risky. On a side note, the first 6 months in junior high school, first 6 months in high school, first 6 months in college are the riskiest 6 months in the life of the kids. Again, the first 6 months transferring from elementary to junior high, high school, junior high to high school, and high school to college. It is very crucial, if you have a kid in those ages, to be very, very closely monitoring them, being there in their life, connecting with them, and praying for them as much as you can, because this is a time where there are a huge amount of pressure, and they want to fit in, and how I'm going to fit in, how I'm going to be accepted, and here when things is being, yes, this, in order to be popular, you need to follow the crowd. In order to follow the crowd, then you need to give in, and so forth. And now the pressure on the kids is beyond. I don't know how many of you is having kids in junior high age. Okay, high school age, elementary, the rest. Okay, do you know? Okay, do you know how now the junior high girls, if they are interested in a boy in school, what they do? How the junior high girl is? Oh, there are kids. Type, remind me with this, and I will tell you the latest about this. And those who are in schools, they know exactly what I'm talking about, or they will know exactly what I'm talking about. So next concept is love. When we ask the youth, what is your definition of love? Eros, physical attraction, I have a crush on so-and-so, sexual relationship, and it is all about taking. It's all about taking. While when you go back to the Bible, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And one of the reason we were in a meeting with in a clergy meeting, and I recall this, I don't know Otsa Kutumabud, both of Otsokum Kutumabudin or no. And Abuna has been helping out for the past 33 years in the Maglisi Kleriki, or in the family problems and issues that is presented to the church. He said, it is only one word. One word is the reason for all the 90 to 95% of the problems that he have seen in the past 33 years in only one word, summarized in one word. What is this word? Selfishness. Selfishness. It is only one word, selfishness. And even selfishness can be there in the concept of love. It is all about me taking, not me giving. Fun, when we ask them about fun, nothing that includes God or church. You cannot mix fun between and God and church. It will never happen. And this is heartbreaking. I will tell you, one of the first hymns I memorized in my life, I was in the middle of the sea, in the beach, with my son, my hymns teacher, and we were a group, and we were fighting, playing together, wrestling, and then he told us, just have a break for 2 minutes, and let me teach you something. And this is one of the very, very remarkable hymns that I memorized while growing up. We have a myth that church cannot be fun. And we cannot create a fun environment and a pure environment within the church that the kids will be approaching or the families will be enjoying, and in the same time will have fun. You will have two families packing to the same cruise line, booking the same room, almost the same rooms beside each other, paying the same exact amount of money, packing their first bag, no Agbaya, no Bible. The second family, there is Agbaya and there is Bible. And you ask them, if you measure the rate of satisfaction, emotional satisfaction or fulfillment in both families, studies have shown that whenever you go outside of yourself, you will feel more even fun. I will give you an example. If you have a very nice movie that you want to watch, and it is towards the end of night, and you are tired, but you didn't pray, and you have to watch the movie. Think of those two situations. You said, you know what, I will watch the movie, then when I finish the movie, I will pray. And you watch the movie, and you slept in towards the end of the movie, and you woke up in the morning. Oops, I didn't finish the movie, and I didn't pray. Or you prayed before the movie and you watched the movie and you stepped in as well. What would be the feeling? How would you feel in both situations? Which will be more relieving and more, it has more self-satisfaction for those who really value their relationship with God? It will be, yes, I prayed and I felt relieved. So you are not doing any sin, but the whole point is when you have God in your life as symbolized with, or as manifested, or as obviously in your life with the life of prayer, then there is a complete different mindset in our satisfaction. Commands those who are rich in this present age not to be haughty, nor to trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God who gives us richly all things to enjoy. God is giving us all things richly to enjoy. So God is after also having fun, and we have fun with Him. And in our life, God does not want us to live a miserable life, which is completely different than what the kids are saying. Anything fun does not include God or the church. Success, having lots of money, cars, houses, and be rich, simply be rich. This is all the measures of success. And whatever he does shall prosper, in Psalm 1 verse 3, and the Lord was with Joseph and he was a successful man. So the whole concept of success, you remember the two couples, it's all about money, it's all about raising a godly kids. And God was, so the definition of success is being in the presence of God and you will be successful. And this is a crucial thing, because sometimes we are, I don't know if you have seen schizophrenic people or not, but we are living a schizophrenic spiritual life. Said Sunday, I put on the badge of a Christian, I go to church, I take communion, my kids in Sunday school, Monday, sometimes Sunday after liturgy in the parking lot, it's done. And I am completely putting on a different persona with a completely different mindset, as if God is not there anymore in my life. You know, I paid my dues, or I'm done with this point in my spiritual life or this relationship with God. Do you like stories? Okay. There was, this is a real story, the names are fake names. Peter had a brother, his brother was a rebelling brother, always disagreeing with mom and dad, always giving them hard time, always confronting them, always putting them down. And Peter was the complete opposite of his brother. The dad passed away, the mom is severely sick in her in the hospital. Peter stayed with his mom in the hospital for over than 4 weeks. It comes the final exams for medical school, and they had the oral exam. And his mom, while she was talking with him, asked him, how did you do in the exams? He told her, forget it, this year I'm not going. So she told him, why you are not going? And he told her, I can't leave you, and in the same time I didn't study, so this class I'm failing, no way. So she told him, please, for my sake, go to your exam tomorrow and we will be praying, and may God intervene. Peter obeyed his mom, he went to the oral exam, he entered the exam, an Islamic Salafist professor sitting on the desk, having a glass bowl, having numbers in the this glass bowl, and this is his way of thinking. You come inside the examination room, you pick one of the papers in the bowl, it has a number, based on the number I will ask you the question in my question list. So it has a question list. So Peter, definitely his name is Christian, in front of an extremist Salafist professor or Muslim professor, and everyone was aware of this guy. So Peter picked, and the number was 1, and he said, Allah Ahad. God is one. So Peter didn't know what's going on. He said, okay, whatever. He asked him the first question, no answer. Second question, no answer. Third question, no answer. He went through the whole list, no answer. So he told him, Peter, I want to tell you something. Because you chose number one and God is one, God cannot fail. Okay? So tell me why you didn't study. I told him, my mom is sick in the hospital. I've been with her for the past 4 weeks and she's critically ill. So I told him, okay. He flipped the paper that has the questions and he told him, okay. Tell me the exact situation, the clinical case of your mom, with all the criteria, all the history, all the tests that has been done, all the prognosis and all the plans and all the treatment. And if you presented it well, I will give you full mark. This is what he told him. And Peter was the most happy person on earth. This is the same thing that he had been doing in the past 4 weeks, deeply involved with his mom in his medical condition. He presented the case of his mother and he got full mark. And it was because of prayers of his mom. You cannot calculate success with materialistic things only. You cannot calculate it with the materialistic things only, because there are many people who are successful in life, but their success, that the Lord was with them. The Lord was with them. I know Abuna departed in Egypt, and I know this Abuna since I was maybe in elementary school, and we were talking when we were in junior high. He was the lead servant of high school, and when we were in junior high, we were looking to this. He was a lead servant, not Abuna. In that time, I was telling him, we are counting the days till we are in high school, so as we will be together in your classes. Believe me, this was the feeling of all the people in my age. He got ordained as an Abuna. He departed. He got really sick, and he departed last August 21st of last year. And I have seen this Abuna unbelievably. Anything that this Abuna, his name was Nabil Ibrahim, and after his ordination was Abuna Mikhail Ibrahim. It is just a coincidence with the same name of Abuna Mikhail Ibrahim that departed. Everything that Abuna Mikhail did was extremely successful. Extremely. He never failed. To the extent that it's a huge church that you have maybe 10 or 12 clergy, and every major problem in the church, when everyone is being, you know what, we don't want to deal with this, they will call Abuna Mikhail. Abuna, this is your responsibility. Give it to him 6 months. Peak. Complete, unbelievable. We have seen it, and there are two people who know whom I am talking about. Unbelievable person. And it was very obvious that he was a man of prayer. Every single thing he did was successful. Not because he was a superman, as simple as that, he was a man of prayer, and God was with him. And when the Bible is telling us, whatever he does shall prosper, return back to Psalm 1 and see the criteria of success. Happiness, when we ask them about happiness, the majority of them said in possessions. Take heed and beware of covetousness, for one's life does not consist in abundance of the things he possesses. Our life is not valued by what we own or what we have or our possessions. Holiness. Do you know what the kids said about holiness? Just guess. This is for monks and nuns and saints. Don't talk to me about this. This is no way. But when you return back to the commandment of God, pursue peace with all people and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord. It is mandatory to live a pure life. It is not optional. It's nice. Because the Bible is saying something completely different. Pursue peace with all people and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord. It is not Abuna Bula, this is teaching. This is what the commandment of God. And here, when we are reading the scripture and we are comparing my beliefs and my thinking and the major difference, not to make me feel bad or to go in a guilt trip, but in order to have ask myself, okay, maybe I need to change this. Maybe I need to look to things in a different way. Maybe I need to honor things. Do you have kids here? Or the junior high thing? Now in the junior high schools, if a girl is interested in a boy, she's sending him a sexual provocative text, just in the beginning, and just something a little bit provocative, to tell him that I'm interested in you, and if he replied her back, then she knows that he is interested in her. If he didn't reply, she take off more clothes and picture herself and send it to him through text. Are you there? This is the mindset of girls in this age, in this community, in the life that we are living. And we are, if we are oblivious or we don't know exactly what is going on in the life of, at least in the environment of the kids, then we are deceived. I can't forget this. It was 12 midnight. I was visiting a group of friends in Canada. My time was very tight. By the time I reached them, it was 12 midnight. Maybe they have 6 or 7 families, over then 13, 14 kids. All the kids are awake and not even a single voice in the house. All the kids are awake and all of them, they are silent. What was going on? They are on 13 iPads. Miracle. Just give the kids iPads, give them iPhones, smartphones. Don't give me a hard time. Just this is the pacifier, the electronic, the e-pacifier. And giving them access to internet, an unmonitored and uncontrolled environment. And you don't know exactly what's going on. You really don't know exactly what's going on. What this might lead them to, or might push them to. The whole point is, in our mind, or in the mind of those people whom we asked, this is obsolete. To live a pure life, this is obsolete. But in the scripture, the Lord is telling us, it is mandatory. It is mandatory to live a pure life. Even if you are married, even if you are single, regardless of the situation, or your age, or your marital status, or anything. Abuna Tadros Ya'ub, he told me personally this story. The first confession that Abuna had in his life, he just got outside of the monastery, and one of the people told him, Abuna, I want to confess with you. 70-year-old man falling in sin. The sin. And Abuna, after the confession, was feeling drowsy. He couldn't tolerate the confession. He went to his father of confession and told him, what's going on? And his father of confession told him, God is sending you two messages in the beginning of your priesthood. God is sending you two messages. Number one is to know that we are all weak, and we are all human beings, and we are all vulnerable to any temptation, regardless of your age, regardless of your marital status, regardless of anything. The second thing is to take care of yourself, not to trust in yourself, and to know that God is the one who is protecting you and covering us and covering our shortcomings. And without God, we cannot live a pure life. And I remember Abuna held his hand and told me, do you see this hand? I told him, yes, I see it. So he told me, there is a flesh here or no? So I told him, yeah, there is a flesh. So he told me, since there is a flesh and there is a breath that is going in and out, we are vulnerable to falling. Whether you are Abuna, whether you are a bishop, whether you are a leader in the church, whether you are a servant, a lead servant, whatever. We are human beings and we are weak. And that's why when we are aware of our weakness and we know that holiness, without which no one will see the Lord, then it is mandatory for us to live a pure life. And here when the scripture is giving us a completely different point of view than for the sake of this idea, I Amba Yusuf, the bishop of the south, he explained it, but with the help of some people who did it in a PowerPoint. So what is the difference between animals and human beings? The animal is composed of, the animal is, we are speaking about body, spirit, and soul. Body and spirit and soul. The animal has a body? It has a body. Does it have a soul? The soul, what I mean by soul, emotions, motives, instinct, desires. Does the animal have souls? Definitely yes. If you have a newborn baby and you have a pet, and the newborn is being carried all the time, and you find the pet is really, really jealous and trying to attack the little newborn because they are taking the attention. So animals, they have emotions and feelings. So animals, they have body and soul. While angels, they have spirit. While human beings, they have the three. We have spirit and we have body and we have soul. What is the only thing that differentiates us from animals and, or what is the only thing that differentiates us from the human beings from animals? Is the spirit. And what is the first thing that the spirit, what is the first thing that the spirit does? Worshiping God in the form of, in the form of prayer. So I wanted to tell you that when we ignore the role of our spirit and we ignore the role of our spiritual life, the only difference between us and the animals is in the spiritual realm or in the spiritual life. In order, if we live according to the flesh, you shall die. So if we live according to the body or the soul, we shall die. But if we through the spirit mortify the deeds of the body, we shall live. And the spirit here is uppercase symbol for the Holy Spirit. So in order to fit a triangle, if you put the whole world, if you put the whole world in a triangle, will it fit the triangle? Will the triangle be fulfilled? No. You need what? You need what shape you need to fill a triangle? Another triangle, which is the Trinity. We cannot be fulfilled. Because sometimes you think that you will be satisfied when you get married, but after you get married, you find yourself even more lonely. What's going on? Then I thought that marriage would be the solution. Now I'm even feeling more lonely, and now that what I did to pursue, or one of the things that I did to pursue marriage, is not to feel lonely, and now I'm married and I'm feeling even more lonely. It's very frustrating and heartbreaking. The whole point is we keep searching for satisfaction even if we put the whole world in our hearts or in our life, even if we have the whole. Even if you are more rich than Bill Gates and, I don't know, Carlos, I don't know what his name, the second one. You don't know him? You're not following the top rich people? I'm only doing it? Okay. The Mexican, yeah, Carlos, with the Lebanese origin. If I even have all this amount of money, yeah, it will be, even if I own the whole world, but my soul and my spirit will not be fulfilled. Sorry? So, because the carnal, do we have papers or notebooks? Do we? I have a papers, but do we have pens enough for everyone or no? Okay. Do we have paper for everyone? I have a notebook. Do you need a notebook? Okay. So because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, nor indeed can be. So if I'm living with the mind of with my mind, think of this. In order just to make it easier, you have a new phone, and this new phone, every hour it is downloading an app. Okay? Are you there? Every hour the new phone is downloading an app. And the apps that will be downloaded is based on the things that you are exposed to. The apps that is downloaded is being based on the things that you are exposed to. So if there is an hour that you prayed, then this hour will be downloading a white app. If there is an hour that you have been watching movies and news and things in the world, that this app will be the app of the world that will be downloaded. If I'm not praying and I'm not reading in the Bible and I'm going to church once in a while, but I am really involved in my job, I'm really involved in my society, I'm really involved in my school or my in my life, and this is what I'm getting downloaded every hour, every hour, every hour. Do you know that boys, high school boys, this is the latest statistics, said this, that a high school boy heading from home to his school, a high school boy heading from home to his school, being sexually stimulated or exposed to sexual material more than his grandpa going to a pub on Saturday night. Again, a high school boy walking from his school, from his home to his school, getting exposed to sexual material more than his grandpa going to a pub on Saturday night, seeking to be sexually stimulated without even doing anything. So here we are speaking about the new phone that had one app that is being a white app, and every hour it is being or download another black app or gray app or black app and gray app, and in the end of the day the phone looks weird and the mind is looking even more weird and the decisions are even more weird and the behavior is even more weird, because the whole thing, you have been downloading all this amount of the things that is from the world. Think of this, that this is our life. I forget about the biblical perspective. Just think of life with the first answer. Are you there? Think that only our life is with the first answer. You have to fit in whatever people are doing. It's all about physical attractiveness, sexual relationship, and take. Another app, nothing includes God or church, is related to fun. Another app, having lots of money, cars, houses, and materialistic things and being rich. Another app, possessions. Another app, purity, forget it. Another app, physical and emotional attractiveness is the key. Another app, working for the body, whatever you want to feed the body, and working on your emotions only, your desires, your passion, and your feelings. What will the life look like? What will the life look like? Scary. It will be, this is all the apps that has been downloaded, and the mind of God is not there. So you have papers and, okay. You do this, fold the paper into half, okay? Then after you fold it into half, fold the half into another half, and the half, the rest, fold it again. So in the end, you have a paper that has 8 8 small boxes in it. Are you there? And the key to this game is to play it very quickly. The key is to play it very quickly. So I will give you 60 seconds, 1 minute. To answer. Okay, are you there? So write in this paper, in every box, the most important things or people for you in your life. You have 1 minute. In every box, write the most important things or people in your life. One in each box. So take those paper, this paper, cut each box together. So separate the 8 parts. Are we done? Okay. Remove 4 papers of the 8. Just disregard them completely. Put them on the side in your pocket. Remove 4 of, so keep the most important 4 for you. Keep the most important 4 for you. If you were very honest, this is very personal, so don't share it if you want to share it or whatever you want. I mean, but this is a late notice. I should have said this before. So remove the 4? Did you remove the 4? Okay, now we are in an aeroplane and there is an emergency landing. And in order to land, you must land, and in order to land, the flight attendant is on the door telling you not, give me 2 papers of yours, of the 4. So you only have, you will give up 2 of the most important 4. Are you there? Unfortunately, otherwise you will die. I'm sorry to say this. You cannot keep more than 2 papers with you. You can't. Simply you can't. I know it is hard. So unfortunately, this is the... Are we done? Okay. Not yet? Give me the 2 papers, please. So you did an emergency landing and you are now in a safety boat. And they are telling you, give us 1 of the 2 papers that you have. Unfortunately, there is a lot of sharks in the area. And you will not be able to make it to the boat without the last paper. It is tough. I did it and it is tough. If you are honest with yourself, it is tough. You need to give up the last paper. This is the center of your life. The thing, the last paper that you had in your hand, is the center of your life. And you do all your decisions when it is really, 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 really hard decisions. It is based on the center of your life. This is true. It is based on the center of your life. I will tell you a sad story. It happened in the time of the evolution in Egypt. There is a guy who had a new car. There is a guy who had a new car. And his wife was sitting with him in the car. And thieves or robbers stopped all the people on the streets. and they liked his car because it was a new car, and they told him, give us the keys and go outside, you and your wife. So he told him no. He replied no. So they told him, okay, it is your wife or your car. He did it. He told them, give me the car and take my wife. This is a true story. And for, it's a very sad story, but it's a true story. It's a true story that I don't know whether it was on the news or not. The last paper that you had in your hand is the center of your life. And based on the center of your life, you are making all your major decisions in life. Whether you like it or you don't like it. This is a fact. If you did this exercise honestly, this is a fact. I remember we did this exercise before, and a lady was really, really distressed because it was her kids. I don't know whether her husband or God in the other paper, and she was really stressed out. She was really extremely stressed, and she didn't know what, don't put me in this decision. Her car and her husband? I don't know about this. Okay. Okay. My apology. My apology for the story. Is the mind of Christ is in this verse, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. And this is the first commandment. When the people asked Christ, when one of the scribes asked the Lord about, tell us the two main, or tell us the most important verse, and the Lord told him, number one, you shall love the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. Did you ever think of what does it mean to love God with all your mind? Loving with the mind, does it make sense? Love is with the heart.
The heart is just a part that would have come from love.
So how to love with the heart? How? My question is how to love God with all our mind?
By giving
our own will to God, by thinking of God more. Yes, when we are obsessed, when we are thinking of God more, then we love God with all our minds. Do you know what the fathers of the church said about love God with all your mind? The scripture. They said, in order to love God with all your mind, you need to have the mind of Christ. In order to have the mind of Christ, you need to read more in the Bible, read more in the scripture, memorize more in the scripture. The more you memorize, the more you love God, and the more you love God on the level of the mind. I will end with this city. So I think you are moving. I don't know whether you are in the plan of moving from your place or not, but assume that you are moving from your place, and you have four cities. City, the name of the first city is N. The rate of crime is 1 in 3. So every three people, one person is being exposed to a crime. Another city is called C. The rate of crime is 1 in 2. Third city is called P. And the rate of crime is 1 in 100. And the good news is there is a city called PNC, and the rate of crime is 1 in 1100. which city you will move into.
We don't care, Abuna. We can live anywhere. The city doesn't get inside us.
Okay, for the sake of the... Okay, which city you are going to choose? Okay.
Whatever God put me in, I will live in. Because I'm not in the city. But if I'm in the city is not going to get inside me.
Okay. This is just an example. I need answers.
PNC,
because 1 in 1100, the rate of crime is much more safe. At least the kids, when they are playing outside, it will be more safe. Actually, this is not cities. This is not cities. This is the rate of divorce in nationwide. Nationwide, every 3 families, 1 family is divorcing. In blessed California, every 2 families, 1 family. This is real numbers. Every 2 families, 1 family is divorcing. What is the city P? Rate of divorce for family praying together, 1 in 100. 1 in 100. You know the P and C? Family praying together daily and going to church every week. The rate of divorce of family praying together daily and going to church weekly is 1 in 1100. It is sad for me to tell you, when Christ is the center of our life, that our families are united and we are living a happier life, and we will be better off by having Christ in our, or the center of our life. It is very sad, but unfortunately, or fortunately, I don't know either or. So when we speak about that, we as a family, we should live a life of prayer. Okay. We should go to church together. Nice idea. Okay. But really, it makes a difference. Do you know why it makes a difference? When we pray together every day, what is the difference that this makes? Any answer? Any idea?
If it gets in the same mind, like we pray together, we can have a set of mind together.
Yes.
So we can pray for the same thing.
You can pray for the same thing. What we are, if we are different and we are having an argument?
We ask Abuna, Father of compassion, and he will solve the problem.
We will have peace in us.
We will have peace inside of us. There is a story about a couple that they were working in the same place. And they have only one car, and whenever they are going to their work, one day they are slamming the doors of the car and they are going very upset and looking extremely sad. So this couple, they had a friend who was a very righteous man, very godly servant in the church. And he asked him what's going on. They told him, no, forget about it. So she is not going to change. And she is saying, you know what, forget it. He is not going to change. And that it's much, much complicated than this. He invited himself on dinner with them in that day. They had dinner. They resolved the issue. And he asked them one request. He told them, can you promise me one promise? So they told him, okay, what is the promise? He told them, pray our Father who art in heaven. This is easy. But he told them there is one condition. So what is the condition? When you pray our Father who art in heaven and you say, forgive us our trespasses, yes, as we forgive the trespasses of others, mean it. Don't fake it. Mean it in front of God. You cannot go and pray in front of God and you are not forgiving your spouse. How come you are going to tell him, forgive me my trespasses as I'm forgiving others their trespasses? How come? So they told him, okay, we'll do it. After 3 months, he went and checked on the husband and he told her, she never changed. And he checked on the lady and she told him, he never changed. So he was wondering, but things has changed. I mean, haven't seen you that upset as before, and that angry and sad and upset. And so they told him, it is because of the promise that you have made us to sign up for. So they told him, he asked them, okay, tell me what's going on. If for example, in the morning he asked for something and she didn't hear him, so he started yelling that she didn't hear what she was requesting, so she felt bad, she closed up, she didn't communicate with him the whole day. He went to work, he returned back, and now it is almost an hour before going to sleep and praying together as we promised. So what shall we do? And we cannot fake our prayers in front of God. So he started to figure out ways of, you know what, instead of reaching to the last minute and standing in front of God and praying, and we cannot pray in a fake way, then he tried to solve the problem before going to this point of prayer. So he went to the kitchen, started looking to the dishes that needs to be washed, and he told her, do you need any help? He tried to help her. He apologized, told her, I'm sorry that I really raised my voice and I yelled at you in the morning. And she told him, you know what, it is my problem also. I have a hearing problem. And they kissed and they hugged each other and things went okay. And when they prayed, they were honest and genuine in their prayer. And simply, sometimes issues are not being resolved. But the presence of God, you are over the issue. As when, if you remember when the disciples were in the boat and the boat was shaky and there is a huge storm. And this huge storm was shaking the boat and they were drowning. Christ came inside and he did not rebuke. He did not rebuke the storm. But they felt peace. Why? Because in the presence of God there is peace. He is the King of peace. So with God's grace, I will stop here for the sake of the time. But it is not a life of praying in a family and in a church. And I know that there is a very nice goal. I don't know if everyone is aware of it. Or a very nice plan will be there for helping us grow in our prayer life. And also going to church has proved that it is uniting us. I will give you an example of going to church. If we are going to take communion, I am going to church and walk to take communion, and we have a fight or argument. We will resolve the fight or the argument before going to church, because we cannot take communion while we are upset with each other. Does it make sense? You are just faking it. You can't. And when we are genuine in doing this, here we are more united and we are more closer to each other, because we are more closer to God, to whom is the glory forever and ever. Amen. So tomorrow we'll have the tabernacle we'll show you the tabernacle as a model, and then we'll go to the lessons that we can learn from the tabernacle as a message for us in our spiritual life, and we'll take it from there.